Welcome back, video creeps. I specifically said that I wasn't gonna do this because I don't want to get bogged into doing a whole franchise at a time.
But the forbidden fruit must be tasted.
So now we're gonna take a look at the homoerotic, controversial Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2. So sit tight, because this is Freddy's Revenge. First and foremost, I'm doing this review without a hat on because Ditlev said that he's never seen one of my videos where I'm not wearing a hat, and now I'm all insecure about it. So here's no hat, just for you, buddy. So this movie wastes no time at all. We see a school bus driving down a suburban street, and then boom, Nightmare on Elm Street, followed by an incredibly underwhelming font. Seriously, what the fuck is that? Helvetica? What, was Comic Sans taken? Was this movie made on Windows Notepad? I want the juice when it comes to my fonts! You gave me the milk. We see a buttoned-up comb-over by the name of Jesse, and he's sitting on the bus while kids are just getting dropped off one by one. He's not sitting with anyone, he's just rocking a pretty heavy school shooter energy. But before he can get called out on it, the driver goes cross-eyed cowboy and goes off-roading into the desert. And the kids on the bus, they're not cool with it. But why is this happening? Well, driver of the year turns out to be Freddy Krueger. Holy shit, that was really soon. Wasn't expecting his revenge so quick. We cut back to the bus and it's just like, it's balancing. What a fucking unwinnable situation. But luckily, this is all just a dream.
I used to read Word Up magazine.
And Jesse treats us to a nice feminine scream. Jesse gets out of bed and we see in his room, it's just filled with boxes and bubble wrap. Nothing in the boxes, just boxes and bubble wrap. Jesse heads down to breakfast, where his dad is like, motherfucker, you better unpack your room. And I don't understand what the energy is about. The fuck do you care how soon it takes him to unpack his room? What, are you trying to go in there and hang out while he's at school and shit? He's a teenager. The cum is just caked on the wall. He can barely breathe in there. That place is fucking ground zero. Let the boy be, man. We meet the adorable neighbor girl, Lisa, and the two of them get into Jesse's Dodge Dart, and they joke around about Grand Theft Auto, and the two head off to their very sexist school, where the boys play baseball and the girls play archery. I'm pretty sure there's irony somewhere in there. Just can't put my finger on it. We meet Grady, who is the real love interest of this movie, and the crescendo that leads to the dance begins to play. Alright, maybe it's not as subtle as a crescendo, but this leads me to my next point. Now, I don't want to harp on the fact that this is the gay Nightmare on Elm Street film, so instead of constantly calling out when gay things happen, because gay is subjective, I've developed an awesome little gay shit counter. And as the movie progresses, our little gay shit counter will count all the gay shit. Now, Grady goes on to tell Jesse that the house that him and his family just moved into belonged to a crazy woman by the name of Nancy. But luckily, this is not a haunting movie, so we should be good, right? Right? It's bedtime for Jesse, and he can't sleep, so he decides to get up and walk around in his little nurse's shirt. Seriously, what the fuck is this bullshit shirt? He goes down into the basement and sees the silhouette of somebody moving around. And in a super rare occurrence in a horror movie, he goes, you know what? Nuts to that. I'm not doing that. He turns around to go upstairs and tattle to daddy. But oh shit, Freddy Krueger got ya.
I need you, Jesse.
But before we can find out why, Jesse is woken up. And again, much like Nightmare on Elm Street 1, this movie toggles that line where you don't know when somebody is sleeping and when somebody is awake. We need Santa Claus in this bitch. The next day in class, Jesse is nodding off, and before he knows it, there is a snake trying to neck hug him. And I'm gonna count this as a gay thing, so. I'm gonna count it because so much of this movie is interpretive. And it's all in lieu of a man facing his demons when it comes to his own sexuality. So figuratively or not, I'm gonna say having a big thing wrapped around you that looks like a dick counts. Lisa in a pool. Now Jesse goes to join Lisa in the pool, but his cock-blocking father tells him, "Whoa, whoa, hold up, motherfucker. Did you unpack your room? You better take that ass upstairs. Way to break the bro code, dad." But Jesse finds a way to get back at him. We make
love in the night. How do you like that, man?
Yeah, you really showed him. Dad's feeling like a real punk bitch right now. Now, it's funny. This movie has a supernatural dream demon. There's this heavy gay undertone thing that's happening throughout the film. But the most memorable thing about this movie is this dance sequence. That's just a good song. And those are some funky moves, brother. Now Lisa from the pool is wondering why there is not a fist inside of her yet. So she heads over to Jesse's house and catches him mid-body rock. Also, that dance scene gets a point. Lisa stays so that way she can help Jesse unpack his room. But somehow in the closet, when Jesse moved in, he didn't see that there was a random fucking diary on the shelf. It doesn't take a fucking sniper to see this fucking book.
This.
How did Jesse miss that shit? But they take a look through the diary, and they find out that this thing belonged to Nancy Thompson. Now, while these two are being nosy as fuck, Jesse comes across a page where Nancy is talking about a man who has been terrorizing her in her dreams. And Jesse is like, "Oh yeah, I know that guy." Now, tossing and turning in the middle of the night, Jesse finds himself in the midst of a Salvador Dali painting. A little melted clocks, anyone? Also, Dali was gay, so... This scene is so cool, too. I love seeing Jesse go over to touch his lamp, and it's just melted the shit. And he turns over to go look at his phone, and it's just destroyed. It's so hot in his room. He's feeling that boiler room temperature that Freddy Krueger is known for. And now this scene, I have to give a lot of assumption and imagination to, because for whatever reason, when Jesse gets out of bed to leave his melted room, he intuitively goes downstairs to the basement, to the furnace, where he finds Freddy Krueger's glove. How the fuck did you know that that was there, but you didn't see a diary in your fucking closet? Now Freddy Krueger pops up and tells Jesse, "Motherfucker, you would look good if you slipped that shit on." Because Freddy wants Jesse to start killing on his behalf. Does anyone watch my channel who's like a Marilyn Manson fan? Because I just thought of this. Would you kill for me? I love you enough to ask you again. Would you kill for me? But Jesse says, "Hell no, peer pressure." And he runs away. The next day at school, we find out that Lisa is having a pool party, and Jesse and Grady get some bro time together. Now, I'm only going to talk about this scene a little bit because it's so fucking stupid. But remember how I said this isn't a haunting movie? Well, there's a scene in this thing with a bird. And, it seems like a fucking haunting movie.
Damn it! Ow!
I'm really not a fan of this scene at all. Part of what makes Freddy Krueger intimidating is the fact that he targets and isolates teenagers. He gets them into an insomniatic state where they're a zombie, and the parents don't understand why. I feel like this scene destroys that isolation. And it happens a couple of times in this film. Later on, a toaster sets on fire in the kitchen where everybody is. I like these effects. I like the idea of a killer bird flying around the room and attacking the father. But I don't like these elements for a Nightmare on Elm Street film. It just doesn't fit. That's not a very long scene, and it ultimately ends with the bird just spontaneously combusting. God, that seems so fucking stupid. But logically, the father is like, Jesse, you did this! And you did it with a cherry bomb! Motherfucker, do you not understand how cherry bombs work? Also, something annoying about this father, he gets cut on the cheek, a little baby gash cut on the cheek, and for the remainder of this movie, he has like a bandage on his face. Pussy. But after he finishes yelling at Jesse and accusing him of doing this magic trick with a cherry bomb and a bird, Jesse stands right up for himself.
Look, you can't talk to me like that.
Jesse, come back here. Jesse,
can't.
Come back here, Jesse!
Can't stop it, you're being ridiculous.
That's Jesse!
Now we pick up with Jesse in the middle of the night and he cannot sleep, so he gets up and I'm not sure if he's dreamwalking, if he's in the dream world. It's one of those situations in a Nightmare on Elm Street film. But ultimately, this takes him to a gay bar, where they are not carding, and Jesse is able to get his underage drink on. But just when he's about to take that first swig, his coach from school, wearing a very interesting outfit, takes him to the school so that way he can run a lap. And then make him get naked so that way he can take a shower? That's not even a gay thing. That's just, I think that's pedophilia, dude. But again, not being a haunting movie, as Jesse is in the shower, the teacher starts to experience some pretty weird stuff. The man is getting pelted with balls, people. Then he gets tied up, stripped naked, and then, spanked. Then we see Freddy arise, and he guts this motherfucker good. But when the steam settles, it is Jesse standing there, wearing Freddy's glove. The cops end up taking Jesse back to the house because they found him naked on the side of the road. I know it was a different time, but if you saw this brown dick laying on the side of the road, your boy's going to jail. The gym coach's death becomes public knowledge. Turns out Jesse was not sleepwalking. Later that night, Thing from Adam's Family pays Jesse a visit and he's wearing Freddy's glove. And he goes to check on his little sister, who's doing some real creepy shit in her room. So Jesse's just like, let me just close this fucking door. This next scene is another one that I think is really fucking stupid. Jesse and Lisa end up going to where Freddy used to work, and Lisa has, the only thing they end up finding is a rat. However, this discovery leads Jesse to stand over his sister's bed to murder her in her sleep.
It's late. Go back to sleep.
But she wakes up and saves her own life. And I know that there's no implication of something weird going on here, but there's something about him standing over her in the middle of the night without wearing a shirt. It looks rapey. It's the night of Lisa's big pool party, and Lisa has a one-track mind to turn Jesse into a human pile driver. Jesse, not feeling it, decides that he's gonna go and put his clothes on, but Lisa, like a fucking predator, follows him, and the two end up, like, weird kissing for a while? Seriously, look at this shit. I actually lost wood staring at that. And the creep always maintains an erection. Why do you think I only record this part? Things start to get turned up as Jesse is pawing at Lisa's tits, and he starts kissing down her belly so that way he can give a girl what a girl wants, what a girl needs. But just then, Jesse's fancy tongue turned into Freddy's tongue, because these two, they share everything now. But before Lisa can see and tell him, no, I want you to lick me with that, Jesse dips out to go be with the person that he really wants to be with.
Jesus Christ!
Now, this is one of those scenes that definitely is a little bit more clear-cut, showing what Jesse's underlying desires really were.
Something is trying to get inside my body.
Yeah, and she's female and she's waiting for you in the cabana. And you want to sleep with me.
And I really love this scene. Not just emotionally, but for me, visually, the coolest effect happens in this scene. Jesse sleeps while Grady is on lookout, but eventually Grady is like, nuts to that, I'm tired, I'm going to fucking bed. But as soon as Grady decides to do this, Jesse has a moment. And this shit looks so fucking tight. And what happens next is so fucking cool. Freddy steps out of Jesse and is now in the real world, and he's right within arm's reach of our buddy Grady, who does not make it out of this thing alive.
Run! Open it up! Run!
And when Freddy goes to take a look in the mirror, it's Jesse. He sneaks out of the window like a bandit before Grady's parents can see and identify him, and he heads back to Lisa's where he confesses that he just killed Grady. Lisa shares with Jesse how Nancy was able to defeat Freddy Krueger, and then turns into the most supportive woman I've ever met in my life.
Fight it, Jesse. You created him, you can destroy him.
Lisa, open this door.
He is living off of your fear. Jesse, fight him!
I can't!
Yes, you can! Fight him! You are not afraid of him. He doesn't even exist.
No!
Seriously, how many people do you know that you can go to with blood all over you and have them still be like, no, you can defeat this? But Jesse is not able to contain Freddy Krueger, and the Jazz Man decides to attack everybody at the pool party. And this scene is so unfortunate for me, because you can see how much work went into it. Freddy is setting pools on fire, and he's slashing and killing people and shit, but there's no way around the fact that Freddy Krueger against a group of teenagers like this who can see him looks stupid. And it doesn't even make a whole lot of sense. I don't know what kind of friends you had growing up, but me and my buddies, we were fucking tough as nails. If someone came to our pool party and started fucking around like that, me and my friends are gonna end up killing a man. And then we have a secret for the rest of our life. Right, guys? Now, Lisa's dad is a terrible shot, and this is enough to make Freddy leave this party. And Freddy proves that you don't have to be at a party for very long to make a big impression.
You're looking at the master of leaving parties early. The key is you have to make a strong impression, so you want to have a picture taken. You want to say some peculiar non sequitur that people remember. You want to note something unique, a talking point for later. I don't mean to brag, but New Year's Eve, I was home by 9.
Now heading into the final act of this movie, Lisa heads over to the power plant where Freddy Krueger used to work. And after a short chase between the two, the power of love compels Freddy Krueger. Lisa, still seeing the part of Jesse that's in Freddy, makes out with him, and this is enough to expel Jesse from Freddy. Now, while that is batshit and fucking so stupid, I actually do like the way that Freddy looks when he's being dismantled. I like the end of Freddy in this movie. Except until we get to Cocoon Jesse. That shit, it just looks fucking ridiculous. The movie ends the same way that it starts, with an evil bus and the credits roll. Also, at some point, you see this weird fucking thing. Get those masks off those dogs, man. I don't like that shit. The video creep is all about saving puppies' lives. Alright, right off the bat, I'm gonna tell you, this isn't my preferred Nightmare on Elm Street film. I think because they broke so many of the rules that were established in Nightmare on Elm Street 1, this made for some really uncomfortable scenes. Something else that I'm gonna have to hold against this is that it is extremely light on kills. Besides Grady and the coach, these are the only personal upfront kills that we see. And yeah, you could argue that there's the pool scene where a lot of people die at once, but it is not an intimate thing because we don't know who those people are. It would have been one thing if Lisa's best friend, who's in this movie, I don't know, got cut in half or something, but that doesn't happen. Freddy's makeup in this as well is maybe the worst that I've seen in the entire franchise. It's not even that it looks terrible. It's just comparatively to part one or every other installment in the Nightmare on Elm Street saga, this one is lacking. Which is weird because Kevin Yeager is the one who did it. The other thing is that while I love that we have a final boy, I do think because it is Nightmare on Elm Street, it would have been nice to have a girl lead. You watch this whole movie and like, yes, it's a Nightmare on Elm Street film, but it doesn't feel like it. In that final act where Lisa goes after Freddy, it actually feels like a Nightmare on Elm Street film. I think the biggest thing that hurt this film was the absence of Wes Craven. He did not pen the script, he didn't direct it, he wasn't involved at all. So I think this was a team of people still trying to learn how they can work out all the kinks of a Nightmare on Elm Street without Wes being involved. And I think there was a lot of trial and error. But this movie was necessary to get to better films like Dream Warriors. And I don't want to be too negative about this film because there are things in it that I do enjoy. Jesse's dance scene is one of my favorite things ever. I also like that they made Jesse look bad over time, his dwindling appearance. From the beginning of this movie, he looks pretty sharp. And towards the end of it, his hair's sticking up, he has these dark rings, he's fucked up looking. I do like that kind of progression in my films. I gotta give props to everyone who acted in this film as well, because the entire cast did an amazing job. And the special effects were also fantastic in this, when we got them. But by far, the best thing that this movie has going for it is the performance by Robert Englund playing Freddy Krueger. This movie could have been worse, and I think we would still love it if it was Robert still playing Freddy. There's a certain magic that happens when he slips on that glove and gets in those prosthetics, and he brings it in this film. The last really good thing that I will say about this movie is that I thought that the writing was really smart, especially because it has this tongue-in-cheek, gay thing going on throughout it. I thought the way that they turned a phrase and they wrote this script was really clever.
My ranking for this movie is...
forgettable.
What were we talking about?
Unfortunately, for as much as this film has going for it, I don't care about this film. And it didn't do anything to expand the world of Nightmare on Elm Street. Going forward into Dream Warriors, it expanded. It made more for the lore. We even learned a little bit more about Freddy Krueger and his background. That's what a sequel should do. But what did you guys think of Nightmare on Elm Street 2? Is this your favorite Nightmare on Elm Street? Do you hate it? Whatever you think, let me know in the comments below. And as always, if you're not already subscribed, please subscribe and hit the notification bell so that way you know when my next video is up next. And I will see you guys on my very next upload. Peace, video creeps.